welcome to Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez. Antisemitism is defined as the hostility, prejudice, or discrimination directed against Jews as a group, and it is considered a form of racism. A very difficult topic to address dispassionately, but we will give it a try. In 2013, I listened to my guest, Ms. Eileen Gotlieb, present on Bowen System Theory's view of antisemitism. I was impressed by the way she, being Jewish, was able to look at this issue in a neutral way, a state I was having a hard time maintaining as I listened to the description of what had happened. Her presentation has stayed fresh in my memory for more than 4 years. I finally found the courage to invite her to discuss antisemitism on Family Matters. Ms. Gotlieb has studied Bowen Theory for nearly 40 years. She has served as Education Director of the Florida Family Research Network, coordinating, developing, and presenting programs in Bowen Theory throughout the state of Florida. She and her colleague, Jeffrey Miller, also created Bowen Theory South Florida, a training program for clinicians and other professionals. Ms. Gotlieb has observed and studied societal regression, or emotional process, for decades, which is the concept in Bowen theory that describes regression in a society, and she has applied this knowledge to the understanding of antisemitism at different times in history. Eileen, thank you for being here today. Welcome.
Pleasure.
So definitely a difficult topic to address in a neutral way. What helps you to do that?
Certainly Bowen theory, having a broad view of the human relationship process, being able to respect that man has evolved from lower forms of life, and the automatic piece, the piece of him that is responsible for his emotional reactivity and the patterns of behavior that operate outside of his awareness, is always there. It's just a question of what it takes to bring it out. And in periods of great societal upheaval, where there are environmental challenges, where there are changes that shift the availability of resources and the extent to which populations are able to manage themselves, that all of that plays a part in a society being more vulnerable to projecting its anxiety onto a segment, usually a minority, usually a weaker element, weaker in the sense that they don't have the power to affect their own well-being in the face of segments of society that can treat them in a subordinate way. Bowen talked about the three components of societal regression: three people, chronic anxiety, and then the triangle, in which two of the parties relate to the third as if it were subordinate, or it's a more mutual process in which both parties participate, even if unwittingly, or the third party, the outside party, behaves in a way that inclines the other two to view them as subordinate.
I remember that when you described that, saying that there's reciprocity in the relationship, and that everybody has a part to play in a discrimination such as antisemitism, there was quite a response from the audience, and some people got upset, some people got like aggravated by what you were saying. Do you remember that happening?
I do. And I don't think that's unusual, because in most cases, when you think about a process of scapegoating and one party being the victim, it's very difficult to consider that that party which is more vulnerable has a part. But without the ability to see that part, there is no way to move beyond the idea that it's entirely the more dominant party's responsibility for what's going on, which in the long run, I think, makes it harder on that weaker party.
Mm-hmm. Can you pick one historical time that you would like to use as a way to describe what you are saying now in theoretical terms?
Well, I had the opportunity to study in detail the Crusades and the pogroms of 1096, which took place in Northern Europe. They took place at a time when Northern Europe was experiencing a warmer climate, and so there was a longer growing season that encouraged the migration to that area for people to be able to farm. They were also encouraged by the nobles in the area to do that, and that led to a lot of deforestation. As a result, the Jews who moved into those communities, and in fact were actually given monetary incentives to move in, came into communities that were totally unfamiliar with the Jewish population and their way of living. Likewise, the Jews tended to be pretty insulated. They had experiences elsewhere that inclined them to be very suspect of their communities. So you had this certain amount of distance, and it did not help people to be less anxious. There's something about distance and a lack of contact and understanding that contributes to the anxiety. So that, coupled with the Crusades, which was this tremendous impetus to rid Jerusalem of its Muslim population, brought the Europeans across Northern Europe on their way to Jerusalem. And part of that involved pillaging and murder and genocide, which wiped out a significant population of Jews in that area. What's interesting and what most people don't know is how the Jewish population reacted to that. And rather than allow themselves to be murdered by the Crusaders when they knew they were in a position that there was no way out, they chose to murder their own families. And the elders in each community determined that each family, the parents, should kill their children and then kill themselves before allowing themselves to be murdered by these random bands of clerics who were not necessarily representative of the Catholic Church, but they got caught up in it. It's a beautiful example of how chronic anxiety can take on a life of its own, and then things become more and more chaotic, and the process just runs its course.
So what ideas in Bowen theory have helped you understand what happened? Because you describe what happened, and in my head it's like, whoa, what's going on? What's the logic behind what's happening? How do you think about it?
Societal regression, in my view, contains all of the same forces that are part of the regression in a family. So you have chronic anxiety, and if a society is exposed to stress in the same way that a family is, those patterns, which are always there, become accentuated. And what we're talking about would be things like emotional reactivity and emotional cutoff, the triangles, the projection process, reciprocity, and the multi-generational process, which would be all of those patterns that had played out in previous generations on a societal level, now being activated and accentuated. So those processes interact with the level of differentiation in a society, the extent to which a society can hold fast to its beliefs, its principles, its values, and its institutions in the face of change. And where that is not possible, then the ability of the society to handle itself is greatly compromised. And one example of that is anti-Semitism and these pogroms that occurred where the scapegoat were the Jewish communities that were relatively new in Northern Europe at the time of the Crusades.
So in your mind, how is it that Jewish people have been the focus of that projection or scapegoating over and over in different times in history?
I can't be certain. I just know that that is the case. I think it's somewhat different from historical episode to historical episode. For example, in terms of the Spanish Inquisition, the thing that I think most people don't know, and I had the great privilege to read Netanyahu's The Origins of the Spanish Inquisition. And he talks about the fact that the Inquisition did not target people who held fast to their Jewish identity, who did not profess to be anything other than who they were. It targeted the conversos, who were the people that under coercion and pressure converted to Catholicism. Now, in fairness to them, it's important to understand the kind of pressure which was placed upon them. They were deprived of all rights, privileges, the ability to have property, the ability to work. And so, in desperation, they gave in. But in the end, it became part of their doing in, because the Inquisition went after people who pretended to be Catholic when in fact they weren't. Mm-hmm. And there was very little evidence necessary to suspect somebody and then eventually
condemn them.
So how interesting to think about those people who were able to hold on to their actual identity, to be certain of self, to be clear about who they were. And they were not touched by the Inquisition.
Until they were expelled to a different region.
Right, or chose to leave.
Mm-hmm. How do you manage to think about this without going to the territory of blaming the victim? It's such a thin line between what you're saying and blaming the victim.
Well, I think you have to respect what all of the parties involved were up against in terms of the level of chronic anxiety that was operating in society at that time and the degree to which people had evolved in an understanding of self, principles, and the capacity to manage, there's variation. Some people were able to do their very best under the worst of circumstances, whether it was the perpetrators or the victims. And you see examples of that in 1096, in the Spanish Inquisition, and certainly in the Holocaust. That variation, I think, is well addressed in Bowen Theory, that there are different levels of functioning in any group. And so there were people in each of those periods of history who not only managed to preserve themselves, but they helped preserve others. Mm-hmm. And likewise, there were those who completely succumbed to the irrationality and the emotional reactivity and the automatic patterns that were not helpful.
How can you use that understanding that you have acquired through by researching and studying history to what we are experiencing now? It sounds like today there are more and more expressions of that type of me against you, and in particular with the Jewish people as well. Other groups are also the target, but let's just keep focus here with the Jewish people. How do you see what's going on today?
I think it's a continuation of this same long-standing pattern of a society under stress and the push on the part of certain elements for togetherness, which in the short term calms society. In the long term, I think it contributes to the divisions, in the sense that individuality is overshadowed. Mm-hmm. And in a situation like that, to what extent are people less likely to take responsibility for their own beliefs and for clarity of principle, and then being able to operate out of those positions rather than join the togetherness piece of it and succumb to an emphasis on what is different rather than how much similarity there is among all of us. So I think to the degree that there is an increase in anti-Semitic behavior now, how is that a marker of where we are, mm-hmm. in terms of the chronic anxiety and in terms of the ability of people to stand up and be principled?
When you describe that there's a variation in the response in every situation that you have studied, there's variation.
Yes.
I mean, I want to think about myself as being part of those who react more, as you put it, based on principle. But what are the things that could help individuals in the face of this very contagious anxiety to stay in a good place in terms of capacity to respond more creatively and constructively?
I think a knowledge of history is helpful to understand the facts of how these things have occurred across time, and certainly a knowledge of one's own family. Hmm. To be able to look at that family objectively, to see its strengths, to see its weaknesses, to know which patterns have served the family in a way that has helped it to prevail, not at the expense of others, but by being part of the bigger picture, being able to consider the interests of the family along with the interests of society. I think to the extent that any group, not just Jews, can relate to the bigger society and respect whatever those beliefs and ways of managing their lives may be, while at the same time holding on to what is essential to a particular group. Judaism has been around for 5,000 years, and it has endured some very significant assaults. 6 million people died in the Holocaust. However, 6 million have been replaced in the time since the Holocaust. So clearly there has to be some very deep-rooted understanding of how we see ourselves, who we are, what is important to us, and then what we're prepared to do about it.
And how do you understand that as a group, the Jewish people haven't been able to move away from being the most vulnerable in societies? Why again and again?
Well, that's an interesting question. What is the part that they may be playing in that, that they have yet to address? I think that my experience is that the Jewish community throughout history at times has been isolated and insulated. And there's a reason for that, which is, to what extent has that helped them to adapt in a society where they know they're vulnerable? And had they not done that, perhaps they wouldn't have prevailed. But there's the other side of it. How do you protect who you are and what you stand for and what's important to you, while at the same time being open to connecting to the other parts of society?
Something like, if you adapt or get involved too much with the rest of the society, you lose your identity. But if you go too much into isolation, you create the tension. So where to stand?
Yes.
Something like that?
Yeah. I would think that at one extreme or the other, that there is more anxiety driving the process than thoughtfulness and clarity of self. There's something about that balance, and Bowen describes that in terms of societal regression, that an optimum society is one where there's an equal balance between togetherness and individuality. But he also speaks to the idea that as anxiety increases in society, that balance is disturbed. And there is a greater movement toward the togetherness end of the continuum, away from the individuality, until that process also reverses itself and you can end up with people who are clamoring for their rights more than thinking about their responsibilities.
I guess that in the togetherness end of it, you have on the one hand the erosion of who you are, because you have to just be part of the rest. And also there's a tendency to point at who's different.
Yes.
And that's where the scapegoating comes. So everybody's in the same togetherness, whether you're in one side or the other of the camp somehow.
I was thinking about the Spanish Inquisition and the Holocaust, and two things that struck me in studying is the degree to which certain members of the Jewish community were absorbed, amalgamated more into the broader society, to the extent that, to some degree, they forgot about their Jewishness. And naively, they thought that if they could become part of the broader society by ascending in positions of power and wealth mm-hmm. and importance, that it wouldn't matter. But that's not how it played out in either case.
What do you mean it would matter?
That it wouldn't matter that they were Jewish.
Oh, okay.
That they would fit in. And certainly in Spain prior to the Inquisition, Jews occupied positions of seniority and importance. But when push came to shove, they converted out of fear of losing what they had worked so hard to acquire. Similar thing happened in Germany with certain aspects of the Jewish population. It became more important to be German than to be Jewish. And actually, the Reform movement was born out of that. It was born out of the necessity to be comfortable in the broader society and at the same time to be Jewish. So there's always that very fine line of how do I retain the essence of who I am and at the same time be part of this bigger group.
But I would like to go back, circle back to what you said at the very beginning of our conversation, that this is an automatic ingrained in our humanity sort of response. Could you tie that back to that idea?
Yeah. How do you become aware of that automaticity? How do you observe it in yourself? How do you observe it in your family? How do you observe it in the broader society? And what is the value of being able to do that, to then understanding that that is always a possibility, especially under great stress and pressure. And so if that's accurate, if Bowen's observation is accurate, then what is my responsibility to be aware, to be observant, to know what is happening at a point in time, and then more importantly, to think about how am I going to manage in the face of that? How am I going to bring to the surface a broad view, a view that encompasses these various processes that are described in Bowen theory, and ultimately to work from a position of self to handle what's going on in a very thoughtful way?
Quite a challenge. Thank you for being here and discussing this important topic with us.
My pleasure.
I'd like to remind you that the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family offers the community affordable psychotherapy in both English and Spanish. If you would like more information about our topic or the services at the Bowen Center, please visit the website at www.thebowencenter.org or send me an email at familymatters@thebowencenter.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter or call 202-965-4400. Thank you for watching, and I invite you to join me again for another edition of Family Matters. I'm Dr. Mariana Martinez, and your family does matter.